Morning, folks. I'm filling in for Terry today under not the best of circumstances. We got a call late yesterday afternoon that Terry's mother is not doing well, taking a turn for the worse, and bad enough that they had called in the kids to come. So sorry they couldn't be here, but please think about them today. Say a special prayer for their family. They need that today. Want to welcome everyone today to worship this wonderful windy day that the Lord has provided. If we have any visitors today, I know we've got a couple. We're glad to have you, and please continue to be with us as you can. Welcome those that are worshiping online. We're glad that you're able to worship that way. We hope that you can join us here at some point in time in the sanctuary and enjoy the fellowship. Glad to have Charlie back with us today to bring us God's message, and he and Dana both help us with communion. So we've been a long time since we've had communion, and I know we're all looking forward to that. Some of the announcements, we're still needing contributions for Feed the Future, special program of ours. Also looking for donations for Purple Heart Homes, and we're still collecting donations for the luncheon for the teachers at Scott's, the plastic containers out in the lobby for those who feel like they want to donate to that. Also, Women of Faith monthly meeting will be held next Sunday, May 5th, after worship at Miss Diane Kimball's house. So please bring a dish to share and a $5 or $10 gift, and you can reach out to Diane for directions on to her home. Are there any other announcements, anything that I've missed? All right, if not, I would like to, at this time, for you to stand up and greet your neighbors. All right, at this time, we'd like to do our affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and resurrection of the body, and everlasting. Amen. And this time we'd like our ushers to come forward. Thank you. us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you again for this wonderful day and allowing us the opportunity to worship with you. We ask that you bless each person who was able to give today and bless each person who will benefit from these offerings. Help us to use these gifts to spread your word and help in our community. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And have you ever seen two cuter ushers? I believe at this time we will be doing Children's Church. Miss Lindsay.
Good morning. Okay. Have you ever been tasked with doing something that as a child you're like, there's no way?
Yeah.
Yes? And you're like, when they tell you, you're like, how am I ever going to get that done? I'm just like this big. I'm only, what, 6, 7, 4, 5 years old, right? Well, for me, it's been building a house. I'm like, how am I supposed to get that done, right? I know nothing about building houses. But there's a Bible verse in Exodus 3:12. God says that I will be with you. He's never going to leave us alone, right? There are 5 pretty powerful words that you guys need to always remember. God's word is filled with the same promise to you guys. God will always be with you. Whatever life brings you, whatever jobs that come across, whatever tasks that you think you have to do that may be too big, just remember God is always with you. And it's a comforting feeling knowing that if you aren't up for the job or you don't feel like you have all the equipment to do the job, that He will be there to provide for you. He doesn't toss you into this world and say that you're on your own. He's there every step of the way, giving you guidance and strength and whatever you need, just as He promised, right? Right. So everybody, can you bow your heads to pray? Dear God, thank you. I am glad that you are always with us and don't know what we would do without you, to be honest. That is, thank you for bringing us here today. Bring us back an added number. Amen.
All right, at this time, we would like to look to support those in our congregation and friends who need our prayers and our thoughts. As I mentioned, especially Sandy and Terry and their family today with her mother not doing so well. Others listed in the bulletin for prayer concerns, Linda Peek, Helen Combs, LaVon Gallagher, Ruby Beatty, Larry Elkins, Freddie Summerlin, Steve Church, Harold and Louise Fulp, Chris Harris, Kathy Howard, Kathy Fulp, Thelma Keever, Mary Edna Lewis, Doris Ann Talbert, who at least this shows is still in Maple Leaf at this time in 418, Ashley Gregory, and the family of Eileen Wall. Also want us to pray for today for our military and fire police, first responders, and especially our military guy of the day, Michael Berg. I think he jumped up and left, but we're glad that glad he is back with us today and safe. Are there any others? Okay, yeah, all right, yep. Remember those and HL. Any others?
The Diane Melvin family in the passing of her mother this week.
Okay, all right, thank you. Thank you, Kyle. All right, this time let's go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we lift up our friends and neighbors to you today. We ask for your healing touch for all those mentioned today. You know all those that are suffering. And we ask you to provide your comfort and strength and grant them your divine grace. Please give comfort to the Gallagher family. We ask for your healing for our nation and all the conflicts around the world. And at this time, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us so many years ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And this time we'll turn it over to Charlie to bring us our message for today. Thank you, Charlie.
Church, good morning, good morning, good morning. So, to be honest, I don't know whether to be sad or relieved. Last week, I saw my wife sing so pretty that y'all offered her a basket of candy. So this morning, I made a promise to myself that I was going to sing as loud as I could so y'all would offer me that same basket of candy to get me to stop. But it didn't happen. So either I don't sing as bad as I think I do, or y'all were just being nice. Either way, I appreciate it. I'm a child of the 90s. I grew up in especially the latter part of the 90s. You know, when you turn 16 and you get your license and you get freedom and you taste freedom for the first time. And just a time of life that you always love and you'll always cherish and you'll never forget. And so that time from 96, 97, 98, that's just a really bright spot in my life. And anytime I talk about the late 90s, I begin to smile. One of the major parts of my life that happened to form who I am today was that I was a part of a church that had a wonderful youth group. And I loved that youth group, and I loved my youth leaders. Their names were Glenn and Tammy Lambert. They built a house while we went to church together. And in that house that they built, not in the house, but in front of the house, they built a pond. And so they had a man-made pond, and they used that for many youth events. And there were many times that I found myself just there at their house hanging out. Over those couple of years, we grew really close, and they became an extended part of my family. So much so that one day, Glenn and I were sitting out at the edge of the pond, and he said, "Charlie, get in the canoe with me." They had a little canoe, and they'd paddle out to the middle of it from time to time. I had no problem getting in that canoe, because I totally trusted Glenn and who he was in my life, and the not-so-little secret that you learned about me on those youth trips was that I had a healthy fear of water. Many times with youth groups, you go to the beach or you go to a water park or something like that, and I was always kind of on the sidelines at those days. I had a family that had a healthy fear of water, and they instilled that in me. So I got in this canoe with Glenn, and he paddled out to the dead center of the pond. You know where I'm going with this. Turned around in his canoe, and we were face to face, and he said, "Charlie," he said, "sometimes you have to just face your fears." And he stood up. I didn't know how to swim. I'd made it clear to everybody that I didn't know how to swim. I was very comfortable with my lack of ability in water, because if you always stayed on land, swimming was never an issue. And slowly, Glenn began to rock the boat back and forth, side to side. Before I knew it, I had a death grip on either side of the canoe. Now, Glenn, on a good day, was about 5'6". soaking wet, he was about 125 pounds. Now, never claimed to be the biggest person in the room, but I know I'm not the smallest either. And I remember telling Glenn, if you do this, if God sees fit to get me back on land, you will regret this. 20 seconds later, he turned that canoe over. And I learned real quick that I did indeed know how to swim. Fear can be a powerful force for us some days. And in the scripture today, we are going to read about a man whose fear got him in trouble. We find a story that Jesus told, a parable, in Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30. And Jesus says then, again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who returned, received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the masters of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold, and see, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. And see, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share in your master's happiness. Then the man who received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed? Well, then you should have put money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This parable is commonly taught. I would be surprised if you haven't heard about it before. And in the typical teaching, we're taught, just like these servants who took their master's money and invested and made more and gave it back to him, we're taught, take your talents, take what God made you to be, take the gifts that you have, use it in service of the church. Increase those talents tenfold, and as you do, the kingdom of God will grow greater and stronger. Do not hide your talents in the ground, because that is not expanding the kingdom of God. And this is all well and good and true. This church is full of members, many of whom have been lifelong or the majority of their lifelong, and have used the talents they have been given to help grow this church to what it is today. However, there is a part of this that I feel like sometimes we ignore. And a lot of this comes in verse 25, and it's when the one man with the one bag decided to bury it. Now, I was always taught this, and I think it's true. And that is, when you start explaining, you're losing. Well, this man brought his one bag, and he immediately started to explain. And he says, "Sir, I know you're a hard man." But he says this in verse 25. "So I was afraid and went and hid your money in the ground." Here's your bag of money back. I want to focus on that one word, afraid. Fear. And what this man said was, "I was afraid, so I didn't do anything. I took no risk." I can tell you this. Living a life with fear as your motivating factor is an incredibly difficult life to live. Fear keeps us from taking chances. Fear keeps us from being bold. Fear keeps us from doing those things that we're always a little curious about, but never quite allow ourselves to do. And I see this more anywhere than in the sports field. Sports psychologist once said, people who play timid focus on failure. They become to the point where they fear failure. And in order to play anything, well, you have to have a degree of fearlessness. Dana told you last week that I love baseball, and that's true. I loved it because I played it. Growing up, I moved around a lot. I lived in Shelby, in Hendersonville, in Broadnax, Virginia, Athens, Tennessee. And baseball was the one place where I could make friends. Now, I was not the best. I would never claim to be. But I was good enough that you wanted me on your team. And I was always the new kid. But a few games in, I knew everyone. And when I say everyone, I mean teammates, parents, and everybody. Because it was the one place in my life at that time where everything made sense. The rules made sense. How you played made sense. What you needed to do made sense. There was order to it. But nothing stunk worse than being in a slump. And when you're in a slump in the game of baseball, it feels like there are 37 people on that field. And there is no place to hit that ball because all you do is get out. The longer you're in a slump, the worse it gets. Because you start playing timid. And you're so focused on not messing up that that's exactly what you end up doing. I wonder, can fear prevent our spiritual life from being all that it can be? I mean, I think back to this story with the servants, and surely there had to be some risk on what they were wanting to do. I mean, what if they took those bags of gold, went out and invested and lost it all? What if the money had been stolen? What if too late they get out there and they find out they're not that good at trading and they take their master's money and invest it in bad things? What if God's calling me to teach that Sunday school class and I mess it up? What if my neighbor across the sanctuary is going through a rough time, but I feel like I don't know them well enough to go by and just say, "I'm praying for you"? What if I want to go to church next Sunday, but I just have something on Saturday night and I'm too tired to get up and get ready? What if? What if? What if? There's a true temptation to safety, right? There's always a temptation to do what's easy, to do what is familiar, to do what we know is right. There's always a temptation to take what's right there in front of us. And sometimes I think God calls us to be bold. I think God tells us that in Scripture, I will be with you wherever we go. And we have to take that to heart, and we have to move forward, and we have to understand that though some things may be scary, we face that fear knowing that we never face it alone. For me, this is personified. When I was in college, I spent a summer at Kennedy Children's Home in Kinston, North Carolina, way out east. It was right after Hurricane Floyd, the year after, to be honest with you. And as you drove through town, you could see the water lines on the buildings to where the rivers had risen and flooded the entire town. While I was there, I met two house parents. I was there as a summer missionary, so my job was just to live on campus and get to know the kids and be a witness to them and be as good as I can to them. But there were two house parents in particular named John and Linda. They were from Boston, and you knew that they were from Boston because they had that Boston accent. And I would try to replay that accent for you, but a man with a southern accent trying to imitate a Boston accent is not a pretty sight. But as you talked to them and you learned about their life and you learned about who they were and you learned about the things that they had gone through, you find out that though they were from Boston, they lived in the Caribbean for a time. They also lived in Denver for a time. They also lived in the plains of Texas for a time. They also lived in Canada for a time. And I had a conversation with them, and it still shapes my ministry to this day. And I asked them, I asked Linda in particular, I said, how did you know that God was calling to you to every place that you had lived? And her answer shocked me. She looked at me as clearly as she could, and she answered with two words. She said, I didn't. And I said, then why did you go to all those places? And she shrugged her shoulders and she said, I've always figured that it didn't matter where I'd go because God would always be there anyway. Later on, I learned about a term called prevenient grace. The idea is a grace that goes before, that God comes before you and has already been there. I have to be honest and say that there was a time where my theology was that God was this great big man in the sky that always gave me a fork in the road. And I had to make a decision about which one to go down. And if I went down the right one, I would receive blessings galore. And if I went down the wrong one, I would be zapped and have a story to tell later before I turn around and made the right decision. Linda threw that theory for me out the window that day. And I know the risk that I'm taking when I'm preaching a sermon like this. The counterpoint to this is, well, then we can just live our life reckless and make any decision that we want. I am not saying that. Please hear me. But what I am saying is that there is a clear difference between living your life always in fear and living your life in faith without fear, knowing that God is going to be with us in the good, in the bad, in any point in between. That's a hard place to be. Because the temptation of safety can always make us feel as though we have to get everything right in order to receive the full blessing of God. And that's a problem because we are a congregation full of flawed people who have never been 100% correct on the decisions that we've made in our life ever before. Amen. So let's change our outlook from, oh, we've got to make a right decision if we want God to bless us, to God is going to bless us, and we have to live in such a way that we believe that blessing is coming. In the movie Facing the Giants, man shares a story, and I know I'm going to mess this up, so please correct me after the sermon. But he basically said that there are two farmers who prayed to God in the middle of a drought for rain to come. And one sat there and waited for the rain, and the other went and prepared his fields. Church, whatever we're going through, as a church, as an individual, as a group of people, let's go prepare our fields with the knowledge that God is going to be with us no matter what. And that, yes, we're going to mess up along the way. Today when we have communion, I've been given instructions and I've already told everyone that I'm going to mess them up. But we live life in such a way that we have the grace to know that God is going to be with us no matter what. There is a YouTube video by a man named Mark Rober. He's an engineer. And he was an engineer who got fed up with the squirrels constantly in his bird feeder. The head nods tell me that he's not alone in this. So he decided that he was going to have fun with this. And he decided that he was going to put his bird feeder on top of a box of walnuts and create an obstacle course for these squirrels to get through to get to those walnuts. And this obstacle course, I'm telling you, if you want the link, come see me after church because I love it, is full of trap doors and catapults and mazes and tight ropes that these squirrels have to figure out how to navigate to get to these walnuts. Sometimes I feel like we put it on ourselves to be the squirrels. That if we don't make the right decisions, or if we don't do the right things in the correct order, that a catapult's going to launch us into the air and make us start all over again. Or that a trap door is going to go off and we're going to fall through and we're going to have to start all over again. Church, I tell you, I serve a God of love, and I don't believe a God of love is eager to watch me go flying through the air. Then again, I really loved watching those squirrels fly through the air. In this scripture, the ones who took the risk received the reward. Where is the temptation of safety preventing you from feeling the real blessings of God? I ask myself a lot, what if I had never gotten into that canoe because I was scared of the water? Eventually, Glenn and Tammy took us on a trip that was put on by the Baptist Student Union of UNC Wilmington. When I went to college myself a couple years after, the first thing I did was find the BSU. It was at the BSU for 5 years that my calling in the ministry was nurtured and formed. And here we are 20 years later, and I wonder, what if I had never gotten into that boat? Sometimes we have to walk along the edge of chaos. And sometimes we have to take a step into the unknown. I don't know the Indiana Jones movie where he has to step into the canyon. But he has to go on faith that the puzzle he's trying to solve, that there's an invisible step there. And eventually he walks across the canyon. Sometimes we have to trust to take that step, even though we have no clue what's at the bottom of that canyon. But this is the most important part. It's to know that if we take a risk, and if we end up flying or falling, God's love and grace and mercy will never change. And God's presence for us will never change. We will make bad decisions. We will make mistakes. I will make a bad decision before the end of the day. God's love for me will never change because of the mistakes I've made. I think God is less concerned about the percentage of times we get things right and more about the purity of our heart when we make those decisions. So if we fly, if we fall, our Lord will be with us no matter what. Church, I know that it's been a trying few months for you. Dana and I, when we had the opportunity to preach these last 2 weeks, we asked ourselves if you had a chance for communion. When we found out it's been a while since you had communion, we want to give you the reminder that you are one body that God loves. So let us take this day and celebrate together the goodness of our Lord in communion.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, lived, died, arose from the dead, and ascended into heaven so we could live this day without fear. Do not give in to the temptation of safety. Be bold and know that you're a beloved child of God. Join me in prayer. Holy God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for its challenges, because in its challenges, God, you prove time and again that you are faithful. Help us to face this day and the coming days with the knowledge, God, that no matter where we go and no matter what we do, your love for us will never change. Lead us and guide us and shower us, God, we pray, with your love, your grace, and your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.